Cooper.
Yeah.
Your name, Jackson. Gotta squeeze that one in. So here's a question for you. By the way, Ibanez signature guitar, the Jiva, long awaited. Shipping in another 30 to 60 days. If you don't have one, you want one, because it is it's one of the finest guitars, frankly, I've ever put my hands on, seriously. It is an amazing guitar. This woman has done an amazing job designing this guitar. You want to make sure you check it out, because it's a cool guitar. Amazing guitar. She knows her stuff, by the way, FYI.
I should have been offstage.
You probably should have, but you're here. We really want to thank Ibanez for bringing Nita out to see us. Big round of applause for Ibanez. Okay, I've got a question for you. What do you get when you cross a mind-blowing, amazing guitarist with an incredible, positive, powerful spirit? You get the Hurricane, Nita Strauss!
Guys, thank you, Dad, and thank you to Sweetwater for having me. This is my first time here, and I've heard about how amazing Sweetwater was for years and years and years, and nothing does justice to actually being here and seeing the amazing facility and being here with all of you guys. The energy
is that okay? Is that okay,
absolutely insane. And so first of all, give yourselves a big round of applause for showing up in the rain. I'm going to start and end on a little bit of a sad note today. As most of you know, we lost our brother, Vinnie Paul, last night. And please do stay until the end of this clinic. We're going to have a special little tribute to Vinnie, and I'd like you guys all to be there for it. But right now, I think I owe you guys a little more Iron Maiden, is that right?
We'll be right back.
hot, right? So as Thad from Sweetwater so graciously introduced me, I'm Nita, and right now I play with Alice Cooper, but as Thad also mentioned, I've done a lot of other stuff before that. So I want to start out this clinic and this talk by telling you guys a little bit about me and how, contrary to popular belief, I did not fall out of the sky and into Alice Cooper's band. So I started playing guitar at the age of 13, and I'm 31 now, which I don't like to do that math, but it was a long time. I don't know anybody that didn't start playing young that got super good super fast, you know what I mean? So I started playing at 13, and I did my first national tour at 15. And right at that moment, that was the moment that clicked. As soon as I got on stage, as soon as I got in front of people, I said, that's what I want to be doing. This is what I want to be doing with my life. And sometimes you just know, whether you fall in love with somebody, whether you fall in love with an instrument, whether you fall in love with a style of music, you just know, oh, I see a cute couple looking at each other. I'm in love with somebody too. I see you guys. So you just know. And I think that's the first thing that I want to impart to you guys, is when you know something's right, you go for it. Whether it's that person, whether it's that career, whether it's that band, whether it's that style of music, whether it's that signature guitar, whatever it is, you go for it. And that's what I did. And I remember being 15 and going on my first tour. It was Vans Warped Tour, which I think is ending this year, very sad. And it was me and three other girls in my band. All of us were in high school. And we had this van, right? And like everyone starts out touring in a van. So we had this van, and we were all excited. We had the van, we had the trailer, we had 2 months of dates booked, you know, a bunch of kids thinking we can do a grown-up's job with no help. So we get on the freeway, we're from Los Angeles, we get on the freeway, and the van breaks down two exits into the trip. Literally, it was less than 10 minutes in the car, the van breaks down. And we go, what are we gonna do? Right, like we were leaving LA, we had a show in Phoenix or in Tempe the next day. We thought, what are we gonna do? We leave the van on the side of the road, on the side of the 101 freeway in Los Angeles. We got our drummer's mom to come and drive a truck out there. We left the van, I guess, there on the side of the freeway with the mom, and we took off in this truck. And when I say truck, I mean an actual pickup truck. I don't mean like a comfy extended cab, like, you know, cruiser that's meant for driving long distances. I mean a single cab, regular pickup truck with a camper shell. You know, those pickup trucks, they fit two people in the front, maybe three if you cram, but no one's cramming like that for an 8-hour drive. So we fit two people in the front, and then the other two people in the back of the truck, in the bed, under the camper shell. And we did that for 2 months. In the summer, right? So you're like, think about this. And we had this endorsement, right? We had this energy drink endorsement, not the one that I drink now, but a different one. And we had this, you know, in the van, we had this master plan. We had the seats there, pallets of energy drinks here, so we had this comfy, like, bed situation. Not so in the back of the pickup truck. The only place we had to put these pallets and pallets and pallets of drinks was laying flat in the bed, and then we would lay on top of the pallets. So we wake up every morning with these circles in our back and our butt, and that's what we did for 2 months. And it's funny now, you know, this is my 16th year of touring as a professional musician, and, you know, I sleep in a condo bunk on a tour bus, and I have a hotel room just about every day, and I think about those days of being so hot in the summer, you know, because there's no ventilation there under the camper top. So it's so hot in the day and so cold at night. And we were so hungry, you know, we were so thirsty and so hungry. And, you know, we were on Warped Tour, so we thought that there was this compilation CD that was supposed to be like all the bands. And we thought, okay, we put our song on there, we'll make, you know, $30 or $50 a day. That'll be our gas money to get to the next place. We get to the first date in Tempe, and they said, no, this is a giveaway. No bands make anything on this. So there goes our gas money. And there goes our food money, right? So we're going, okay, we're out there, we're booking dates on every single available off date, just so we can get enough gas money to get to the next Warped Tour show. trying to sell t-shirts. We started selling these energy drinks for $1 at our merch table, which we weren't supposed to do. These are our free drinks from our endorsement. So we started selling these energy drinks for $1 at a time, make $15, that's the gas tank, you know what I mean? And I think back to those days, and you know what the funniest part is? That was the most fun I've ever had in my entire life. Not once in that entire time did I ever think, man, I miss home. You know, I don't want to do this. It's hot as heck in this camper truck. My bass player and I weren't old enough to have driver's licenses. So we were in the back on the energy drinks, and the drummer and the other guitar player were in the front, and they had to drive for the entire 2 months. And I'm telling you this because that is literally what it takes. It takes being hot in the summer, and it takes being cold in the nighttime, and it takes being hungry and thirsty and not knowing how you're gonna get to the next city to mold you and shape you into that musician that you wanna be. So don't be afraid of the hard work. Don't be afraid of the DIY tour, and don't be afraid of getting out there and getting your hands dirty on the road, because that is what every musician will tell you has shaped them into a touring musician today. So, fast forward, I'm trying to skip through my usual clinic a little bit since we're short on time today. So we're gonna fast forward a little bit. You guys all know the story of how I started playing with Alice Cooper? Some yes, some no, okay. Well, I'll tell the abbreviated version, so those of you that already know it, don't get too bored. I was playing with a band called Femme Fatale, and we were playing on the Monsters of Rock cruise. And on that cruise was a band called Winger, who I love. And Kip Winger from the band saw the show, and he, as most of you guys probably know, played with Alice in the late 80s, early 90s. And a few months after that, I got a random call. I remember exactly where I was. I was running in the park with a girlfriend, just doing some cardio, and my phone rings. And he said, and the voice on the other end says, "Hey Nita, it's Kip Winger." And I was like, "Really? Cool. How does he have my number?" And he said, "Listen, what do you have going on? What do you have going on for the summer?" And I was playing guitar for the LA Kiss football team, you know, playing the national anthem and stuff. And I had some gigs. I was trying to put a band together. And I said, "Well, you know, I've got the stuff. Why? What's going on?" He said, "Alice Cooper is looking for a guitar player to replace Orianti on the Motley Crue tour." And I said, "My schedule is completely open. I have nothing at all going on this summer. What's the next step? What can I do?" So he said, "Well, you know, send me something to send them. Send me a video that I can send them of you playing so I can show them what you're all about." I said, "Yes, absolutely, yes, of course." And I hung up the phone and I thought, well, what am I gonna send? Because they're not really gonna care about hearing me play some Iron Maiden songs, as much fun as that is. All of my music is super technical and heavy, and that's not going to be interesting. You know, I can probably send some Jermaine Jackson and they'll just throw it right in the garbage. Right? So what did I send them? I sent them the national anthem. I sent them a video of me playing the national anthem at an LA Kiss football game, which I thought was kind of cool because it shows that I can play. It shows that I can hold my own in front of a crowd. There's about 15,000 people at this game, so it shows that I can play in front of people. And how are they gonna say no to the national anthem? Like, if they do that, then anyway. So I sent that, and the following week, I met Shep Gordon, who has been Alice's manager since, I believe, the late 60s. I think they've been together on the better part of half of a decade. You know, I'm sorry, half of a century, not a decade. They've been together more than half of a century, Shep Gordon. And you also might remember him, he managed a lot of the celebrity chefs, like Emeril. Like he has his hand in so many different things. So I met Shep Gordon and Bob Ezrin, who not only did Destroyer and some of the greatest rock albums of all time, but has been Alice's go-to producer since Welcome to My Nightmare. So I met them, and it went amazing. And then they said, "We want to hear you play some Alice Cooper songs." You know, so they sent me over some tracks and they said, "Send us a video of you playing." And I sent this video, and you guys, when I tell you that I pulled out all the stops, I mean, I pulled out every trick that anyone has ever played. I was swinging the guitar around like Mr. Malmsteen. I was playing over the neck, every sweep, every harmonic, every dive that I could fit in. I mean, I was just on fire. And I sent 3 songs of this. Each song's 5 minutes, right? 4 or 5 minutes. So I sent them these 3 songs of, you know, just complete over the top, bananas, mayhem, as cool as I could play. So I sent them these 3 songs, and I sent a text saying, hey, I just want to let you know you should have an email from me. I look forward to your thoughts. And my phone rang about 2 minutes later. So it's 3 songs, right? So it should have taken 15 minutes to watch my audition package. And my phone rang 2 minutes later, and it's Bob Ezrin. And Bob says, this is not what we want at all. Have you ever heard an Alice Cooper song? And he kind of laid into me for the first time and not the last time. And he said, have you heard these songs? Have you actually listened to them? You know, and I was so dismayed because I, you know, in my head, this was it. This was my chance to show them what I could do. And he goes, listen, you need to play these songs the way they're meant to be played. And somebody up there was watching out for me because they gave me 3 different tries to do this. And they could have very easily said, nope, you blew it, you have failed, do not pass go, do not collect $200, you're out. And they let me do it again. And each time I thought, okay, this time I have simplified to the max. I have not. And after the 3rd round, I didn't hear from him for a couple days. And then my phone rang at 7 o'clock in the morning. And, you know, it woke me up, and I looked at the number, it was a Nashville number, and I thought, could it be? And he said, Nita, it's Bob Ezrin. And I said, hello, sir. And he said, listen, Alice Cooper does not need a shredder. Alice Cooper needs a rock guitar player. If we give you the opportunity to play in this band, can you become a rock guitar player in time? Which I think was about 2 weeks. At that point, we're about 2 weeks out of the start of the Motley Crue tour. And I said, yes, of course, yes, absolutely. And he said, you answer that really fast. And I said, yes, I know that I can do it. And he said, good. And then he hung up on me. And this is the thing I love about Bob, is he's succinct. He doesn't say a lot of words to make his point. And he's such a visionary, and he has such a clear idea in his mind how he wants things done, and that's the way it's worked in the Alice Cooper camp for a long time. So he said good, and he hung up on me. And I looked at my phone, and it said 7:02 a.m. And I said to myself, did Bob Ezrin just call me and tell me I'm not a rock guitar player and then hang up on me? And I think it was later that day that I got the email from Shep Gordon with my starting dates for the Alice Cooper tour, and I've been with them since then. So, that day, I started calling around in search of a guitar teacher. And a couple days after that, I took the very first guitar lesson of my entire life. I was completely self-taught as a kid. I don't read music. I barely read tab. I watched DVDs, you know, I watched Marty Friedman, Melodic Control, the great maestro Yngwie Malmsteen play loud, John Petrucci, Rock Discipline. Like, that's how I learned how to play guitar. So I found an amazing teacher in LA, and I said, dude, I need some licks. Like, I need some rock licks, because I don't know how I'm not a rock guitar player. Like, I don't get the disconnect. I thought I was doing it right. You know, in my head, I've been a rock guitar player since I was a kid. So where is this coming from? Where is this disconnect coming from? And I'll play you an Alice Cooper song right now, a kind of very stripped down version of a classic track. And since you guys are going to play a little bit of metal, I'll show you a little bit of the difference, what I learned in that guitar lesson to become more like the Bob Ezrin version of a rock guitar player. Humidity. You guys all have the same problem that I'm having right now? Give me one quick second, I'm sorry. As we do this. One thing that I do in my longer clinic, which I wasn't going to touch on today, is that playing live is 10% of what you actually play and 90% how you react to crazy things that happen. So don't ever forget that. Thank you. So one of my favorite parts of my clinics, and I know we're running a little short on time, but I want to make sure I get a lot of questions from you guys, because I do these all the time, and I can just talk forever about stuff that I think that you guys might want to know, but I would much rather talk about stuff that you guys want to know. So I want to take at least a little bit of this time and open up to you guys. Yes. Do I ever get distracted on stage? Yes, so much. And if we could maybe get a talk back mic somewhere in the audience, if that's possible. If not, thank you for speaking loudly. So the question is, do I ever get distracted on stage? And yeah, of course, you're going to. And if you're not getting distracted on stage, you're not putting on a very good show, I think. Even on the biggest stages, no matter if it's to 100 people or to 100,000 people, I try to connect with the audience and make it a lot more about their show than my show. And I think if you're just there, you know, looking at the guitar and thinking about the notes you're going to play next and thinking about whatever you're going to do next, you're not making it fun for anybody else except yourself. Maybe other guitar players on YouTube. So I think it's so important to be distracted, but don't think of it as being distracted. By the time you get up on that stage, you should not be thinking about anything that you're playing. You know, I always say, nothing good happens in here for a guitar player. Nothing good can possibly come of thinking a lot while you're on stage. The only thing that should be going through your head while you're on stage is, how can I make this show the best it can possibly be? If you're on stage going, oh my gosh, okay, it's 18, 18 is an E, so my solo's coming up at 4 bars, and I have to turn off my compressor and turn on my delay and boost, here we go, and okay, it's gonna start on the 12th fret. You've already lost the battle. Nothing good can happen if you're thinking like that. So be distracted. Embrace the distraction and have fun with it. Yes, in the blue. Yes, I will be playing with Alice when he comes back this summer. Right there in the front of the wristband.
How did you meet the Iron Maidens?
I met them at NAMM, which is the LA industry only version of what we're doing here. It's basically a place where all the distributors like Sweetwater and awesome places like this go to buy their stuff for the year. And I was at a booth at NAMM, and up came these freaking cool looking girls. I didn't have any girlfriends that played music at that time. Like, so up walked these kind of like leather dressed, badass girls. And someone goes, that's the Iron Maidens. And I grew up in LA, and most people think that I started the band or something. The Iron Maidens have been together since I started playing guitar. They've been together since 2001. I started playing with them in 2011, my 10-year anniversary. So they said, look, you know, we're looking for another guitar player. You know, would you be interested? And I said, can I be Adrian? And they said, no. And I said, no, thank you. And so years went by, Courtney Cox, the other guitar player, and I became best friends. We moved in together, we were the best of friends. And they said, can you do this one show with us? It's the House of Blues, my hometown, like the Sunset House of Blues, which is not there anymore, sadly. They said, can you just do one show with us? It's like 10 songs, you know, maybe 12, and it would be at the House of Blues, and we'll pay you like $100 or something. And I said, hell yeah, I'll do that. Play a sold out show in my hometown at the House of Blues. I'll do this one show. And that turned into 4 amazing years of touring and playing Iron Maiden songs. And now I know like 500 Iron Maiden songs. But yeah, so I know. Yes, I'm
fine. Guitar?
I would so love to tell you guys about my guitar. Thank you for asking. So have you guys had a chance to stop by the Ibanez tent over there somewhere and try out my Jiva? So this is actually, the one I'm playing is actually the one from the tent, funny enough. A lot of people think that there's a separate version that I'm playing that's different than the ones that are gonna be sold in stores. It's not. This is, the beauty of the Jiva is that I can go into any music store and pick up anyone in stock, and it's gonna be exactly like my guitar. You'll see, I even have duct tape on it because it doesn't have strap locks on it, so you know. It's gaff taped together. It's really the one from right over there. It's got the same pickups, it's got the same specs, it's got the same everything. So literally, there is no difference whatsoever between my Jiva, which I'll be playing later in a different tuning, and the one that you guys will get in stores. So the Jiva is an S-series body. It's got that beautiful tiny S-series body as you can see. It only weighs 7 pounds, which is something that I love about it. For those of you that play a lot of shows, you know how hard it is on your shoulder playing a heavy guitar. So this, even though it's a solid piece of mahogany, it's only 7 pounds. So it sounds amazing. It's got that mahogany sustain. It's got the... Is that loud out there? It's scary. Wind is scaring me. So it's got amazing sustain because of the mahogany body, but it's super light, super easy to play. It has an ebony neck, my signature DiMarzio pickups, and of course the quilted maple top, which we all know and love so much. I had never seen a black to natural maple burst, and I've always loved seeing the natural wood of the guitar through. It always, and you know, you can see some nice guitars with cool finishes, but for me, I've always preferred the look of the wood grain. So you can see the natural maple color coming through and the trans black on the outside. Beautiful three-piece maple and purple heart neck. And of course, these signature DiMarzio pickups. If it gives you any insight into how long we spent on these, we only did 2 versions of the Jiva and we did 8 versions of the pickups. It took a very, very long time to get them right. And I'm so happy with how they came out. So, this actual guitar will be over at the Ibanez booth for the rest of the day. And I will actually be over there right after this too. I know they got some signing cards made up, so please do hang out with me. I'll be right over there.